Welcome to the Sacramento County District Attorney Election Debate. This event is sponsored by the National Lawyers Guild of Sacramento, the American Civil Liberties Union, and the Justice Reform Coalition, and is sponsored, hosted by Lincoln Law School of Sacramento. I'm Jim Schiavenza. I'm Dean of Lincoln Law School and moderator for this evening's debate. I'm going to read just the bios for each of our candidates so that you're familiar with them. Todd Leras is a former prosecutor of the year in Sacramento, in the Sacramento County District Attorney's Office, and has spent approximately 25 years working in the criminal justice system as a private defense attorney, Sacramento County Assistant Public Defender, Sacramento County Deputy District Attorney, and U.S. Attorney. At the Sacramento County DA's office, Todd was supervising Deputy District Attorney, Supervisor of the Consumer and Environmental Protection Division, and worked in the Gang Unit, Major Crimes Division, Special Assault and Child Abuse Unit, and Domestic Violence Unit. Todd has successfully prosecuted thousands of cases, personally putting bad characters in county jail, state and federal prison. Todd has put away child pornographers, murderers, sex and human traffickers, rapists, child molesters, spousal abusers, drug traffickers, and white-collar criminals involved in such crime as major mortgage fraud. Henry Schubert is a career prosecutor with 24 years of law enforcement experience as a Sacramento County District, Sacramento County Deputy District Attorney. Schubert has sent some of the area's most notorious and dangerous criminals, murderers, rapists, and child molesters to state prison. She has also created innovative programs for the District Attorney's Office focused on catching killers and criminals using DNA evidence, helping the children of our community by combating truancy, and honoring those citizens who have provided service to justice with the development of the annual Outstanding Citizen Awards. One of Anne-Marie's passions is the pursuit of justice through forensic DNA evidence and cold case prosecution. She formed the DA's cold case prosecution unit in 2002 and served as its first prosecutor. She is nationally recognized as a forensic DNA expert. Anne-Marie has received the Prosecutor of the Year Award and the Post-ICI Instructor of the Year Award. The third candidate, Maggie Krell, will not be participating in tonight's debate due to a calendar conflict.
Yeah, right.
We have three panelists who will be questioning the candidates. I'll read their bios as well, short bios. Panelist Claire White is the National Lawyers Guild Student National Vice President. She is passionate about issues including veterans' rights, anti-war activism, prisoners' rights, and prison reform, and constantly strives to build solidarity among social justice warriors of different stripes. Motivated to organize around peace and veterans' issues by her service in the United States Air Force, Claire also serves on the board of King Hall Veterans Association, the Veterans Democratic Club of Sacramento County, and has been instrumental in the foundation of the student-run Veterans Legal Services Clinic at King Hall. Claire, if you stand for us. Mickey Nkoji has worked for more than 20 years as a journalist at daily newspapers in California, including the Sacramento Bee, where she covered, among other things, criminal justice issues. She graduated from California State University Sacramento with a degree in government journalism. She is now a member of the United Auto Workers Local 2350. Please stand. Our third panelist is Roger White, who is the Political Affairs Coordinator for the Sacramento County Chapter of the ACLU. Roger has been engaged in the fight against mass incarceration and political repression as a policy researcher, writer, and organizer for over 15 years. Roger is a graduate of Howard University School of Law and is currently a Senior Research Analyst for the Service Employees International Union Local 1000. We have rules for the debate, and I think it's important that we share those with you as well. Each candidate will deliver a 3-minute opening, and we flipped a coin, and Henry Schubert has won the coin toss. She will go first. The panel of Claire White, Mickey Nkoji, and Roger White will question the candidates. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer the question, with the candidate who answered first to have 1 minute of optional rebuttal. So each candidate will answer each question. The candidate who answered first will have a minute for optional rebuttal. After our panel has questioned the candidates, the audience will be allowed three questions with the same rules for timing of responses and rebuttals. And I'm sure you've seen cards that have been passed around the room here tonight. And Tess will be picking up those cards about 30 minutes into the debate. Each candidate will provide a 3 minute closing, and because Ms. Schubert goes first in terms of opening, candidate Leras will go first in terms of the closing. Okay, are we ready to start?
Good evening, everybody. Thank you to the coordinators of this important debate. I appreciate the opportunity to come here. I want to talk to you a little bit about who I am, what my philosophy is, and why I'm the most qualified candidate to be the next district attorney. Prosecution, prevention, and innovation. That is, in my opinion, what I call the blueprint for public safety. I've been a prosecutor for 24 years. It's the only thing I've ever done. I absolutely love what my profession is. I love what I do. But my philosophy about being a DA is those three important components: prosecution, prevention, and innovation. I'm running for district attorney because I have the institutional knowledge to run this office. I have a long-standing record of prosecuting the most violent crimes in our community. An equally important component of that is I have a long proven record of establishing innovative programs that are not only about stopping crime, but also about preventing crime as well. I'm very humbled and honored to have a tremendous amount of support from the community, really across the broad spectrum of the criminal justice system, as well as the community leaders in this county, as well as the state. And that comes from a number of things, and that's what I want to talk about. Why do I have such tremendous support? Support from law enforcement, crime victims, prosecutors like Jan Scully, or Steve Grippy, or Rob Gold. Why do I have to support from individuals on the defense side like Don Heller, or Linda Parisi, or Bill Portanova, or community leaders like Pastor Weldon, or individuals like that? Why does Anne-Marie Schubert have the support that she has that crosses across all political spectrums, across all walks of life? I have that support because those individuals and the people that stand behind me and believe in my leadership abilities. And I myself believe in myself, and I believe in most leadership abilities. And what does that come down to? That comes down to the fact that I have 24 years as a prosecutor trying cases in a courtroom, over 100 jury trials, and the dean mentioned the types of cases: child abuse, homicide, murder, those types of things. I have management experience, and let's not forget, this is an office that has a $70 million budget. I have made decisions, what I call maturity of judgment decisions, on running the child abuse unit, filing cases, making decisions that affect people's lives, decisions that aren't always we all agree on. I come here because I know that this is an important discussion. Are we going to agree today, Mr. Leras and I, or any of us in the room, on all these policy decisions? Absolutely not. For instance, Mr. Heller and I are going to disagree on capital punishment, but he supports me because I'm honest, and I'm fair, and I'm reasonable, and I have the highest level of ethics, and I'm the most experienced person in this room when it comes to being the next leader that of all those qualities. And those innovative programs that I talked to you about, equal components, I'm going to talk to you about those today. Probably the one I'm most proudest of is our truancy intervention program, where we're getting people back into school so we can reduce crime and make our community safer. I appreciate your vote at the end of this and your support. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I want to start out by saying how nervous I am to be in a law school. I wanted to avoid that. But since I'm back here, I wanted to talk about something. How many of you are law students? Can I see a show of hands? So a lot of you. Let me tell you something, and I can truly say this, that I consider Anne-Marie Schubert to be a friend. We were teammates together in the Sacramento County District Attorney's Office. I respect her. I also admire her. Where I disagree with her is primarily on policy, and I also disagree with her on who's the most experienced person to lead the district attorney's office. And for the benefit of the law students, I can tell you that the one thing that I bring to the table that no other candidate brings to the table is the broadest and deepest range of experience, and that is an unquestionable asset to the next leader of the district attorney's office. I have been on both sides of the criminal justice system. Initially, I was a public defender. And I should tell you, I left a large firm to take that job because I wanted to try cases. I got the trial bug early. And I remember Judge Lally looking at me when I said I was leaving a large law firm to go to the public defender's office and saying, "Are you crazy?" And I've gotten that same question when I left the U.S. Attorney's Office, the largest and most prestigious law firm in the world, the Department of Justice, to undertake this run. But let me tell you something. Everything that I've had the good fortune to try, I've succeeded at. And it doesn't matter whether that's as a deputy district attorney, as an assistant United States attorney, or even proudly, I can say, as an assistant public defender. I've tried cases on both ends, and I think it's invaluable when you've seen the criminal justice system not just from the prosecutor's eyes, because sadly, when you've been a prosecutor for 24 years and that's the only thing you've ever done, the only prosecutor you know is you. But when you've been on the other side and you're arguing on behalf of a real live person and they're saying, "Why in the world is the DA making this ridiculous offer in my case when I sat in court and saw other people who were much worse get better deals than me," then you feel the pain. And you understand why it's so important that the district attorney's office has got to change. And by saying it's got to change, it means that now that we've had a seismic shift in the way we view crime in this county, because the prisons are overcrowded, we need to do what I think I know how to do best. And that is identify the dangerous bad actors, those who victimize, murder, rape, molest, and make sure they get those beds. And then when you sit in court and you see some guy who's got a couple grams, that he's not taking that space away from them. And if I'm elected district attorney, if I have the good fortune of pulling off a miracle and that happens, that's what I'll do. I'll make sure that low-level and first-time offenders are given alternative treatments under realignment, and that we try to get at the root causes of crime, and that those bad actors who spoil our community and ruin public safety are priority one and the ones we put away. So I thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here tonight to talk about those things.
Mr. Lair, if you're standing, you get the first question.
Oh, sure.
And I'm not sure which of our panelists, you have 2 minutes to answer. Ms. Schubert, you will have 2 minutes. And then Mr. Laris, if you'd like, we have 1 minute of optional rebuttal at the end.
And there's our timekeeper.
Yes.
I lost sight.
You were right on time, both of you were. Panelists?
The Trust Act was passed so people in our immigrant communities could talk to local law enforcement without fear of deportation. Yet there's some indication that Sacramento County has held undocumented immigrants in jail for federal authorities when the law says they should have been released. If you become district attorney, what will you do to make sure the Trust Act is fully implemented in Sacramento County?
This is a really important issue because it comes up over and over again in all of the forums and also just meeting with people in groups and clubs and community meetings. And the answer to that is to fully enforce the law and the spirit of the law. I've seen what happens over in federal court with what's called the 1326 proceedings, the deportation proceedings, and I know that there's some controversy about some of the immigration policies of the administration, of the Obama administration. My view is if we're going to encourage people to come in and report crimes like domestic violence and violent crimes, we need to be able to assure them that we're not going to be putting them in jail or that we're not going to be holding on to them just long enough so that someone from ICE can come and put a detainer on them. So that would be the simple answer to that question. Fully comply with the law and ensure that victims of crime are protected from deportation proceedings.
Ms. Schubert?
That Mr. Leras and I would probably completely agree on the issue, which is that we should fully enforce the law. Does the DA's office have a role on who's having ICE holds put on it? No. But what we do have a role in being a leader in this community is working with our local law enforcement, the Sheriff's Department, as well as the ICE individuals that are placing these holds on them and making sure that that's being enforced. But really the second component of that, which I think is equally just as important, is increasing reporting from individuals who may well be here undocumented. How do we do that as an organization? It goes back to my same philosophy of outreach. Okay, we have a U visa process that protects individuals from deportation if they're the victims or witnesses of certain types of crimes. We need to do more as a DA's office, and that is to go out to places like my sister's house or go out to La Familia so that we can educate individuals. We want you to report. We know that domestic violence is underreported. We know that human trafficking is underreported. We want those reports. We want to hold those people accountable, whether it's the pimps, the human traffickers, whether it's the individuals that are committing family violence, because that's good for our community, that's good for them individually, and it's good for us as a whole. So thank you for that.
Mr. Leras, you have time for rebuttal, should you choose?
No, thank you.
Okay. Second question is directed to Ms. Schubert.
The AB 109 realignment law encourages counties to invest in community-based alternatives to incarceration over more jail construction and custody-based solutions. Yet, according to a March 12th article by Sacramento Bee reporter Andy Furlow, 4 out of 5 of the dollars that are spent in realignment in the county are allocated to sheriff custody programs. As district attorney and one of the 7 members of the Community Corrections Partnership Executive Committee that plans realignment spending, do you support the current allocation of realignment dollars? How would you choose between more jails and the evidence-based rehabilitation programs that help people and improve our community?
Great question, Mr. White. Let me kind of give you my concept of realignment, which, and I've made this comment publicly, is that I believe that there's very noble goals to realignment, and those evidence-based programs are critically important to get to what those goals are. However, it is without a doubt the most grossly underfunded effort that was basically placed upon us by the state. To give an example, the Department of Corrections budget prior to AB 109 for corrections was $13 billion. Since AB 109 came in, the Department of Corrections budget has gone down to $9 billion. So they've reduced the state budget by $4 billion. There has only been $1 billion given to the state, to the counties, for the full enforcement of AB 109. And so with that, as the next district attorney, you have to make decisions on how are we going to balance the needs of public safety. We have individuals that are in our jail that, quite frankly, are not low-level offenders, but they are defined, quote-unquote, because the legislature says that. For instance, we have an individual that may well be there that has 2 kilos of cocaine armed with a machine gun that they've defined as being low-level and is now going to be housed locally. So we have to balance those needs. Will I work together with Corrections, Community Corrections Partnership? Absolutely. But I think a lot of it also has to be with following the recommendation of the Stanford study, which just came out in November, which is cap those jail sentences at 3 years, look at the person's past criminal history when they're deciding if they really are low level. And if we can look at those and reduce those numbers in our county jail facilities, we're going to free up the money to get to those noble goals, which I do believe in, and I believe is critically important to get to those rehabilitation services. Thank you.
Mr. Leras?
I fully support realignment, and I think that what should happen with realignment in the next few years under the next administration is that it should move slowly away from the idea of funding the jail and improvements in the jail. And those are needed, quite frankly, in order to house people who used to go to state prison but are now being housed there, and more towards what you just talked about in association with partnerships. Coming up with evidence-based programs that are designed, as I said, to get at the root causes of crime, whether they be beefing up drug courts, beefing up alternative courts like veterans treatment courts, or trying alternative methods of probation that reward good behavior instead of simply punishing bad behavior. By that I mean doing things like reducing time, suspended time, or the term of probation for doing things like getting a job, completing an educational program, completing a job training program, the types of things we want to see offenders doing. But let me say this. I have said I embrace realignment, and I will continue to say that. And the reason is it makes DAs do what they constantly ask defendants to do in closing arguments. That is, we're here about making you responsible for your choices. Now, what I'm talking about there is this. We've allowed district attorneys throughout the state to politicize crime by saying, I'm making you safer by taking offenders and then making them the state's problem. And they could do that across the board when there was plenty of bed space. If you think about it, they could say, we're gonna take drug offenders, we're gonna take people who have violated on parole, we're gonna give them priority for those beds and those spaces. At the same time, what were we doing? We're incarcerating more people for longer periods of time under 3 strikes and under our sentencing laws regarding homicide. Well, now the DA has to be responsible for saying, I want the worst offenders to be the ones who get the bed space. And the only way to do that is to make sure that we keep empty bed space locally and have beefed up realignment treatment programs. So I fully support that concept.
1 minute of rebuttal, Ms. Schubert.
Yes, I'm going to give you a couple examples why I don't support realignment fully or fully embrace it, contrary to Mr. Leras. One, under California's realignment law, Penal Code Section 181, which is slavery, is considered a low-level offense. If you have 2 kilos of cocaine armed with a machine gun, it is considered a low-level offense under California law. That same offense under federal law can get you 40 years in federal prison. So supplying methamphetamine with armed with a machine gun is considered low-level in Sacramento, or in California, I should say. But if you illegally sell horse meat in the state of California, you're considered a violent offender who should now go to straight prison. Straight to prison. Do I disagree with that? I think, yes, those are the types of things. I do not believe that paroled sex offenders should be supervised locally. We, on a local level, see them housed, are constantly ripping off their ankle bracelets. I consider that dangerous for the public, and I think it's dangerous as a parent and as well as a prosecutor. I agree with Mr. Leras. We need to save the bed space for the violent offenders, but there are certain ones that need to go to prison, and we need to redefine what the legislature has done. Thank you.
Third question goes to Mr. Leras.
All right. I'm a veteran, and if I could have the veterans in the room raise your hands. Awesome. Thank you. Right. So if this audience was full of houseless residents in Sacramento County, there would have been probably 55 or so hands that had gone up. The Sacramento County Board of Supervisors just voted on a bill that will crack down on panhandlers, further restricting where they can stand and talk to people. The county DA would have discretion to prosecute after 2 infractions. What would be your prosecutorial approach to these types of cases as DA, and do you have a position on the establishment of veterans treatment courts here in Sacramento County?
Let me take the second part first and say I have a position that veterans treatment programs should be established and fully supported here in Sacramento County. Placer County already has a program that's fully going, and we should have one that's fully going here. In addition, let me say thank you to our veterans for their service, particularly as we're facing Memorial Day. I'm deeply touched by veterans. Every time I talk to veterans, they give so much, and we have given so little in return. With regard to the idea of criminalizing poverty, I think I've already given the response about how I feel about that. Let me say this, the best part about doing this, and it's got many bad parts, but the best part is I remember going out to Loaves and Fishes and meeting with Sister Libby Fernandez and her showing me around and showing me the facility and showing me what she was trying to do for homeless people generally, but also for veterans and along the lines of trying to keep them from getting into trouble. And she said what was obvious, which is, look, you get these people who will get panhandling tickets, who get light rail tickets, and what ends up happening? They don't come to court. And then they get failures to appear, and then they end up being in custody because they're not good risks for release, and they have no money for bail. When I talk about wanting the bed space for violent criminals, I don't like the idea that we're putting those people and we're giving them priority. What's the solution? Well, it seems it's a pretty simple one, and that's this. We already have the Tommy Klinkenbeard Legal Foundation. I knew Tommy when he was alive. I worked with him. We already have it out there. Let's beef it up. Let's send the prosecutors out there to see what homelessness is all about so that they all have to go as part of their initiation and training so they see what it's about. And let's man a court out there on regular basis, time to time, to deal with those issues and take care of them at Loaves and Fishes so they can actually do whatever time they need to do at Loaves and Fishes or in that area as community service. Thank you.
Let me just first address your question about aggressive panhandlers and how are we going to address that as the DA's office. First of all, contrary to Mr. Leras' position, we have Operation Stand Down, where we go out to Loaves and Fishes and we deal with the homeless population, trying to get rid of their warrants or things like that. We also have a community prosecution program where we specifically have a lawyer that's assigned to the downtown area that works intensively with the homeless population to try to get them the services that they need, the serial inebriates, the things that individuals that we have, those types of things. We have to balance, we're trying to balance We want business in the community so our economy can thrive, so our revenue can go up, so we can get more funding for these important things. We also have to balance with trying to find the solutions for the population. And I think we do a great job. Can we do more? Absolutely. We have alternative sentencing. If somebody, if somebody gets filed on a misdemeanor, I'm not saying this is going to happen in aggressive panhandling. Overwhelming percentage of those cases are alternative sentencing. They're not serving time jail. They're going to educational classes. We're trying to refer them to programs so that they can better rehabilitate. I feel confident and comfortable with those types of things. Veterans Treatment Court, since October 2012, our office has been engaged with the planning discussions for that. It's going to launch in about 2 months. There are only 18 veteran treatment courts in California as we exist today. Sacramento County will be the 19th. It is a multidisciplinary approach. It's a tremendous approach. We have been an advocate. Chris Carlson, if any of you know him, he is our alternative sentencing prosecutor. He has been single-handedly from our office developing this program in conjunction with the Public Defender's Office, with the Veterans Justice Outreach Program, and the court. And it's essentially designed to do alternative sentence, I should say, treatment in lieu of jail time for veterans that qualify for services. It's going to be a great program, similar to our mental health program that I ran for 2 years, where we specifically are trying to get individuals out of the system and get them treatment in lieu of any type of jail term. So I'm proud of the work we're doing on veterans treatment.
Mr. Leras, 1 minute rebuttal.
Thank you. I went to law school down in Berkeley, so I had some firsthand experience with homelessness. And then I came here, and I saw that it wasn't that much different, that you would see the homeless. They have been a chronic problem the entire time I've been in Sacramento, and I've been here for 25 years now, as of March. Criminalizing homelessness is not an answer, and that's what's happened during the past 20 years, and it's been increasingly happening. And that's the fundamental problem. That's what the question goes to. It's not enough to say you have stand down, which occurs every so often. It has to be regular sessions of the court. And in addition, it is vitally important, since these prosecutors who are new prosecutors have never, ever seen the people that we're talking about outside of the courtroom, for them to go to Loaves and Fishes and actually visit it and see what happens there and what the problems are that Sister Libby deals with on a daily basis and all those wonderful volunteers deal with. These people don't need to be in jail. They need other alternatives. And that's what I try to do. Thank you.
Fourth question.
Jan Scully recently modified a controversial decision in 2011 to end full investigations and legal reviews of in-custody deaths and officer-involved shootings. Her current policy reinstates legal reviews in a more limited fashion, and investigations are taken up only when requested by the Sheriff's Department. Would you be in favor of reinstating full independent DA investigations and legal reviews of officer-involved shootings and death in custody cases, and explain why or why not?
I've said this position very clearly a number of times now. I fully support the full reinstatement of the review, not just the legal aspect that we have now currently, but prior to the budget cuts, we also had a DA investigator, so a law enforcement will go out to the scenes of these officer-involved shootings or to the in-custody deaths. I would fully reinstate that as well. But the other thing that has not been talked about much is that we also, our office is one of the few in the state that has a crime laboratory. We have tremendous tools there, some of which is crime scene reconstruction. And I think it would be wonderful to engage our crime laboratory to go out to these scenes so that we can, in fact, have a forensic evaluation, not just a law enforcement evaluation, but a forensic evaluation of these scenes. I think it would be, my whole philosophy is, as a DA, I'm a straight shooter. I believe in truth, in fairness. It is what it is. And I believe in transparency, and I believe in clarity of purpose. And I believe that not only does law enforcement want this, but the public wants it, and they deserve it. And with that in mind, I have every intention of fully reinstating it in all three of those aspects. Thank you.
I'd like to think we're both straight shooters. And let me say this, that when it comes to reviewing what an officer does in terms of misconduct. As a federal prosecutor, I was called upon on occasion to investigate officer crimes. And we did that pretty aggressively. And the thing that I hear the most complaint about when I go out to the community in terms of everyday impact is exactly what we were just talking about now, and that's officer-involved shooting. There is a view that the district attorney's office is looking for a way to say, good shoot. and they're not evaluating them from a neutral position, just trying to find out what the facts are, what occurred, and make a judgment whether there was something impermissible that occurred or whether it was a justifiable shooting. And it results in some pretty outrageous feelings on the part of the public and the community when they hear this shooting has been cleared, and they thought when they first heard the news reports about it that it sounded like a bad one. I've seen that happen. We all know the one where there was a guy in the back of the police car in cuffs who was saying he had a gun, he got shot in the face. And when you heard about that, you thought, wow, that's going to be tough to justify. And then a little while later you hear, it was found to be a justifiable shooting. That seems outrageous. What do you do to make sure the process is fair and seems much more fair? Two things. One, as I said, you approach it from a neutral point of view. You assign somebody who's got a lot of experience, and they make an evaluation. And you take input from the community in addition, that you can find out what witnesses and what evidence there is. The second thing is, and I'm not trying to do a Clint Eastwood here, but we could ask Ms. Crow about this, the Attorney General's office is supposed to conduct a review independent of the District Attorney's office to make sure it's okay. I suspect one of the reasons she isn't here tonight is because she didn't want to be asked any questions about that, because she had participated in the review of a shooting in Yolo County that seemed unjustifiable.
That's right.
The fact of the matter is that she needs to answer questions about that so that the community knows she'll fairly evaluate officer shootings as I will.
There you go.
Ms. Schubert, 1 minute of rebuttal.
I think the main thing I would want to mention is that trust needs to be built through a long process, and that's why it's so critically important that your next district attorney, as well as the one that we have now, that you have a good, long-standing relationship with all different community-based organizations, diverse groups, and those are things that we can do internally within the office, and so that there's this open, honest communication. If there's a disagreement, I can't talk to what Ms. Crowell did. I don't know the facts of that case, and I think it's, I'm not trying to defend her in any way, but what I do know is I know who I am as a person. And I know that I believe in honesty and fairness, and that's why we need to have these components that I talked about. An officer, an independent officer sent to the scene, an attorney that reviews it, and a crime laboratory that also reviews it. And then you allow people to be heard, and you develop that relationship over time so that we can understand. We may not all agree on whatever the outcome is. Our office has prosecuted cops on many different types of occasions. Okay? Do they make mistakes? Absolutely. But we need to have an open and honest discussion about that. So thank you very much.
Question number 5 to Mr. Leras.
Everyone on both sides of the debate agrees that California's death penalty is broken. But attempts on both sides to come up with a political fix to it have fallen short. Given this political impasse on the issue, would you publicly support a future ballot initiative that simply replaces the death penalty with life in prison without parole?
Absolutely. Let me say this. I have come out and said that my view is that death penalty is a broken system and one that can't be fixed. And let me explain why. It comes from a number of points of view. First of all, it is unfairly applied and can never be justly applied without considerations of the economic background of the defendant, the racial background of the defendant. When you've seen how that sausage is made, it leaves you with no taste for the sausage. What we have in California is not one death penalty. We have 58. We have one for every county in California. And I cannot think of a way to fix that system so that it would be fairly applied, so that a defendant who commits a crime that is heinous and terrible and warrants the ultimate punishment in San Francisco can be guaranteed to be treated the same way as a defendant who commits that identical crime in Bakersfield. The way things stand right now, God help the person in Bakersfield, and there's no way that the person in San Francisco is going to A, face the penalty, most likely, or B, get a jury composition that decides that it's going to determine that the penalty is appropriate. So what we've done, and I've seen this as a prosecutor, where you prosecute a special circumstance homicide case. If it's life without parole, there is a closure for the family where they know after the appeals are exhausted, after the collateral attacks are exhausted, it's over. The death penalty gives this false promise. it sinks a tremendous amount of money, and then every few years there's some other issue that pops up. Should it? Yes, because the worst thing we could ever do, the worst thing as a society we could ever do, is execute someone who didn't do it. And we've seen instances of that recently where DNA or the Innocence Project has shown us that the person who had been on death row was innocent. We can never have that happen. So we can't speed up appeals. We can't take away rights. That's not going to make the system fair. It can't be fixed.
Herein lies a philosophical disagreement between Mr. Haller and myself. Do I support the death penalty as a matter of policy? Yes, I do. I recognize that it is broken. Just a little bit of background. I'm not a rabid dog about it. I believe it's a decision that should be left to juries. If somebody walks into my son's school or your children's school today and decides to shoot 12 people at random just for the hell of it, then I think a jury should make that decision. California supports the death penalty as a matter of policy. But I also firmly believe that if we do not fix it in the next couple of years, then I do not blame the citizens of this state to get rid of it. Do I think it can be fixed? Yeah, I do believe it can be fixed. I think that there's things about it, and those efforts have been made over time, but for whatever reason, the legislature chooses not to fix it, such as increasing the pool of attorneys. You know, there are people on death row that claim that they did not commit this crime. If you get their lawyers before 7 years, they can have their claims heard earlier. If we can disperse them from the Supreme Court to other courts, we can do that. If we can work on the habeas corpus process, those are the types of things that you get into the weeds work. But I believe that the death penalty, there's less than 2% of all murder convictions across the state. I disagree with Mr. Leras wholeheartedly when he says that this is good for families. I mean, quite frankly, with all due respect, how dare you tell the murder victim's family who was sexually assaulted, stabbed, and raped repeatedly by a serial sex offender and stabbed 70 times before this 8-year-old was put to death by the sex offender. How dare you tell them that that's closure? I believe it's a policy decision that the voters of the state has made, and I think it's our obligation to fix it, but I also recognize if we don't fix it, then it's
going to
be gone. Thank you.
Rebuttal, Mr.
Leras? Well, I'm not going to accept a how dare I, because quite frankly, I've seen what prison is like, and if you had to spend the rest of your life there without any hope, that's its own personal hell. I'm not talking about substituting my judgment. I'm talking about the voters substituting their judgment. That was the question. Do I favor that as a potential penalty? Yes. That's what I've said. I understand the emotional impact that these crimes have because I, like Ms. Schubert, have prosecuted them and have dealt with the families and understand and feel their pain. But my point was this. When the major cause of death on death row is old age, that's not a system that's working. And the fix is not to say, well, you know what? We'll just get less qualified lawyers and send them to less qualified courts so we can speed them along to their deaths. That doesn't seem to me to make any sense at all. I want careful, methodical, and thorough review because being a prosecutor is about justice, not vengeance. And that's what I'm about. Thank you.
Sixth question to Ms. Schubert.
Studies show racial disparities in drug law enforcement, despite the fact that white people and people of color use and sell drugs at about the same rate. Tomorrow, the California Senate will be voting on SB 1010, a bill that will get rid of the disparity between crack and powder cocaine sentencing, something that the ACLU has advocated for a long time. Do you support this and other attempts to end racial disparities in the criminal justice system? As DA, what would you do to help eliminate these disparities?
I'll give my caveat, which is I haven't read SB, what is it? 1010. But I will say this as a frontline prosecutor is, do I think there's disparities? Yes. I mean, if you look at methamphetamine versus cocaine, why is it that methamphetamine can be a wobbler under our law, which is a misdemeanor, and the triad for felony methamphetamine is 16-2-3 versus cocaine, which is a straight felony? I think it's time to have that discussion, and I think that as the next district attorney, I don't have a problem leading that discussion because there is disparity. There's no question about it. And in the trenches, you know, what I've seen, you can see drugs that are used more frequently in certain types of crimes. I've seen it, methamphetamine, you know, a connection between that and child abuse. And so I think it's important for us to have that discussion. Am I willing to lead that? Absolutely.
Rebuttal,
I support the idea of allowing a wobbler in situations just like you're talking about with cocaine, in addition to, we already have it for methamphetamine. But I think you need to go a little bit further too. You have to understand one other thing. Empowering the district attorney isn't enough. What needs to happen also is that there needs to be a policy that's followed where if we decide as an office, as in consultation, that a certain level of cocaine possession, a certain amount, or a certain level of methamphetamine possession warrants a felony treatment, and a certain level under that warrants a different treatment, you don't overcharge a felony in order to coerce a misdemeanor plea. That happens all the time. That's the value. So it's not enough to go there. What's happened in California, quite frankly, is that I dealt with sentencing guidelines as a federal prosecutor. I understand the value. We won't pass them here. Jan Scully said they were too complicated. Well, we deal with them every single day in the federal system. It's a thick book, but once you get used to them, you're used to them and you know exactly what happens. And what do? They ensure that if you commit your crime in Wyoming, you're looking at the same sentencing guidelines if you did that same offense and you have the same record as if you did it in Rhode Island or California. We should really advocate for something similar to that here. Not just allowing for misdemeanor treatment to reduce racial disparity, but also informally in this office, the Sacramento DA's office, the capital of California, gathering together the supervisors so that they can come up with guidelines and treat cases appropriately from the outset and not posture in order to coerce pleas. That's what's occurring. It's wrong. It shouldn't happen. And too many people end up with felony records because they want to test the system and they end up not taking an early resolution offer and then the DA goes in firm and they end up being a felon with all that means. And that's wrong.
Ms. Schubert?
The only comment I want to have is that when we make decisions, I don't have a problem with looking at levels and making decisions on treating people consistently. It's all about treating people consistently in fairness. But as a prosecutor, you also have to look at not only the facts of the crime, which is if you're going to go to the weight issue, that's fine. But you also have to look at what is that individual's background. So for instance, if I have somebody that comes into our court today that has a simple possession case of methamphetamine, that person is going to be treated differently if as opposed to the person that comes in with a possession case who also has a 290 conviction, a prior sex offense, where he was under the influence of methamphetamine at the time of that sex offense. So that's where maturity of judgment comes in, and that's where you have to have experience. Sentencing guidelines, I understand. We consider all that, the facts and circumstances of that individual crime, so those weight issues I'm fine with. But you also have to look at the prior history of that individual. If it's nothing, then I agree with you, but you also have to understand the background to make sure that we're dealing with those issues. So thank you for that.
We've exhausted our questions from the panel. We've gathered questions from the audience, and I can have a mic. Shoot that. And because Mr. Leras went first with questions, Ms. Schubert, you get the first question from the audience. The recent documentary Divorce Court features Sacramento in an expose of judicial corruption involving judges, lawyers, court officials, and the abuse and trafficking of children. There has also been a Bureau of State audit exposing fraud on the court and the bribes to judges, lawyers, and county supervisors. How committed are you in pursuing and prosecuting judicial corruption? 2 minutes.
Well, I'll say this. First of all, I didn't see whoever wrote the question. I didn't see the divorce court expose, but public corruption is public corruption. It doesn't. It is irrelevant to me whether it's a judge, a police officer, anybody else. But I am very committed to that. And I think that there's things that, and we know all from the legislative issues that are going on right now, that it is a very hot topic right now. As the next district attorney, one of the tools that I think that we need, that the feds have right now, is the ability to do wiretaps, because they're oftentimes very challenging cases to prosecute. But for whatever reason, the penal code exempts out public corruption from that tool that law enforcement can have. So do I have any problem going after individuals that are corrupt? No. For those of you that may remember, several years ago, our office prosecuted Officer Brandon Mullen from Sacramento Police Department because he was falsifying police reports. I was the supervisor of the unit that became aware of it, and I was the one that advocated that we go after Officer Mullen and we go forward with what we're going to do. We have a history in our special investigations unit. Do I think we can do more? Absolutely. But I don't have any problem. To me, it's the facts of the crime, and if they committed the crime, we're going to deal with it. So thank you for that question. Whoever asked that.
Thank you. Probably one of the greatest advantages to having been a U.S. attorney is the fact that, unlike in the DA's office, you are involved in a case all the way from investigation, from when it first comes into the office with law enforcement, up until the point where it goes to appeal. That includes, I didn't get this opportunity, but even if it went to the U.S. Supreme Court. I went to the Ninth Circuit on several occasions, but the point is that you become what I think of as a complete lawyer. One of the things that we did there was investigate public corruption, and I had the opportunity to do that. And that included police officer misconduct. And let me say, I have a very, very good friend. One of my best friends in the world is an FBI special agent. And he kept saying to me over and over again when we were doing these cases, and thank God there is an FBI. And I agreed with him. That agency is wonderful in terms of who it uses. So I'm going to tell you that as DA, not only would I fully investigate any public corruption, whether it involved a political figure, regardless of their political party, Democrat, Republican, doesn't make a difference. But in addition, I think that there should be a beefed up investigation, and the special prosecution unit should be beefed up to include looking into any kind of misconduct where it appears that a law has been broken. And if, as Ms. Schubert says, because of limitations in state law, the feds would be able to deal with it more appropriately, well, guess what? I happen to have a few on speed dial. And I know exactly who to call. Not just AUSAs, but also agents who are quite good. And so we would use whatever tools are necessary. One of the shortcomings of the DA's office when I was in the U.S. Attorney's office is that we wouldn't get full cooperation in investigation and prosecution of cases from the DA's office. That's got to stop. I don't know why. I had officers ask me, why won't they work with us? I don't know, but they wouldn't. They didn't. And I was always amazed to see the look of shock on law enforcement officers' faces when it came to pass that we weren't getting cooperation.
I think the thing that I would ask Mr. Leras is what cases he's talking about, because I've had nothing but great relationships with the federal FBI. When I supervised child abuse, we had constant dealings with them. Child abuse cases that overran both the federal spectrum and the state spectrum, and I dealt with the many U.S. AUSAs and some of their agents there, so I would disagree with them there. And I would also disagree with whether or not we get on the ground for public corruption. We do. We have a special investigations unit. At any given time, we have 40 to 50 cases, and we are even at the ground level of those investigations, making sure that we're doing everything we can to make sure that that case is investigated fully and prosecuted to the best of our abilities. So, thank you.
Mr. Leras? What would you do to fix the inhumane conditions at the county jail?
You know, as a prosecutor, you don't get much occasion to go over there. But as a defense attorney, you do. And not only do you see what the conditions are firsthand, well, not firsthand, you go home, but you realize how people are treated or mistreated in many instances. It's the sheriff who oversees the jail and really is responsible for the conditions that are there. But certainly, if you're working in partnership with the sheriff, then you have to address some of the issues that are going on at the Sacramento County Jail. And that means that it's a sort of notorious place. Again, I can sit here and draw upon my experience as a federal prosecutor in hearing about complaints that were unredressed or where they were asking us to do various things in the federal government about that. Where I disagree with Ms. Schubert is this. She asked me about specific cases. I can list specific cases that where we didn't get cooperation. I understand there was cooperation with the SOC and ASAP unit, but in other areas, particularly in the area of gangs and in areas of political corruption investigation, we weren't getting any response, and I still don't know why. Some of those investigations are still ongoing, and from my connection to the officers, I don't know that with this current administration or with the successor administration there'd be any difference. I can say this, that with my connections to the federal government, my connection to the U.S. Attorney's Office, and my understanding, which I think is the most important thing, of what resources are available and what tools are available to combat crime, that I would be much better equipped to be able to ensure full cooperation in redressing things like those kind of issues and public corruption issues. Thank you.
I'm going to answer the question about inhumane conditions at the jail, which is, I think you have to, first of all, as the elected DA, you have to know what they are, and you have to hear from the different individuals in the community that have complaints, and that includes law enforcement, it includes public defenders, it includes criminal defense bar, it includes the jail and psych staff, and the medical staff, and it also includes looking at other jail settings. What does Sacramento County do? Do we do something differently? Have there been complaints? And there we... And then we therefore sit down and all have a meeting and we come back collaboratively and make a decision on, are there things that need to be done? Does the DA control the jail? No. But that doesn't mean as the next district attorney that you don't take a leadership role in making sure that if those conditions exist, that we are remedying those and that we are doing what we call the best practices in our county. So thank you for that.
Rebuttal, Mr. Leras?
Thank you. I'll be quick because I want to talk about the jail and the inhumane conditions. Let's say this. As a federal prosecutor, you deal with people who are housed in different facilities, whether it's Yolo County, Butte County, Nevada County. The one thing you hear over and over again from defendants, and we debrief a lot, that means they come in and they try to help the government, they try to tell us things. The one thing they we hear over and over again is, can you get me out of Sacramento County? Can you get me to Nevada County? Now, there's something wrong, and the DA isn't going to do anything about it currently. Why? Because, you know, I said one of my best friends is an FBI agent. When you work with law enforcement, you tend to really align with law enforcement. And there's been a deaf ear. But I understand this because as a person who has to visit that jail on occasion and visit human beings, not only do I hear about it, but I also experience that mistreatment myself. Let me say that again. As an attorney, I have been denied visits. Or I have been told my attitude is bad because I press a button a second time while I'm waiting to see a client. That's unacceptable.
That's right.
They're doing that to me. What do you think they're doing at midnight when they're doing bed
count? That's right.
Something's got to be done.
The third audience question is directed to Ms. Schubert. What presence will your office have at the state capitol to lobby for additional funding for alternative treatments, AB 109, changes to laws, and representing the concerns that the community has about the DA's enforcement and prosecution of offenders?
I have absolutely no doubt that based on my own experience and my position as the next district attorney that we're going to take an incredibly active role. I have testified probably well over a dozen times at the Capitol on various issues that relate to AB 109, as well as establishing outreach programs for our community. For instance, Assemblyman Ken Cooley partnered with our office on a bill to go out and do educational outreach on sexual abuse so that we can increase the reporting. Unfortunately, it didn't make it through. I went and testified for him on that bill. About 2 weeks ago, I went and testified for him on foster care and the fact that we have an over amount of foster care kids and human trafficking. And how can we address that as a community? I believe very strongly that AB 109, while it has tremendously noble goals, is grossly underfunded, and I have every intention of going to the legislature. And that's where, you know, my relationships that I've had, not just within our community, but also with the legislature, going across and advocating for bills. I've testified on bills related to the statute of limitations, extended for rape cases where you have DNA. That was successful. So we now are able to go back and prosecute individuals that commit rape long ago where we have DNA that can conclusively identify somebody as being the rapist. So I have no problem with doing that. I believe very strongly that prevention is a critical component of public safety, and I will do everything I can. Whether it's, to give you an example, I think we should add a marriage licensing fee of $25, I'm sorry, divorce licensing fee, because we can increase funding for domestic violence. If you add $25 on a divorce violence fee, right now it's on the marriage license. But if we add $25, we can increase the funding for domestic violence services for our community. So those are the types of things I'm talking about. So thank you.
Mr. Leras?
Well, the Capitol is just a few blocks away from the district attorney's office. It's a short walk, and I know not just Ms. Schubert, but you know, a lot of supervising deputy district attorneys are called upon on occasion to go over there and state their position. I think in addition, the DA, him or herself, should be the one who goes over there and explains what's happening to the legislature. And if you think about it, Ms. Schubert can talk about Ken Cooley, and she can talk about relationships with other people. What fundamentally needs to occur is that the district attorney has to have a fundamental approach that's consistent with the composition of the legislature. And what that means is right now there is a fundamental rift between where Ms. Schubert and Ms. Scully are in terms of how they view criminal justice issues and continuing criminal justice policies of the past and where we are now. And I'm not just talking about with members of the legislature, I'm also talking as a matter of public policy. The people of our community have decided that they want to see prevention programs, that they want to see rehabilitation programs instead of incarceration. There is no longer a will to build prisons, but we all agree that the worst and most violent offenders are the ones who should be in the prisons. So what you need is someone who is prepared to go over and advocate for the same view as the people and their representatives. And that's a view that I'm talking about tonight. My views about where criminal justice should head in the future are absolutely consistent with the majority of people who are in the legislature and aren't tied to the past. I've been there. I was a prosecutor in that office. I knew even then that I prioritized the worst offenders, and I'm proud to say that by doing that, I know I prevented a lot of crime and a lot of violence from occurring to victims who otherwise might have been victimized. But I didn't just put dope dealers away, low-level dope dealers. I never did anything like that, and I'm proud of my record, and I think we need to have somebody over there who's advocating for rehabilitation for those lower-level offenders.
We advocate for rehabilitation for low-level offenders every single day at Sacramento Superior Court. What we do that with is diversion programs, Prop 36, reentry court, violation probation court. I can tell you right now that of the cases that we file, felony cases, we do not send low-level, when I talk about low-level, first-time possession offenders to state prison. It simply does not happen. They're eligible for diversion under Prop 36. If that does not work for them and they are not successful, they then are eligible for drug court. There are many, many different types of programs. I disagree with Mr. Leras that it's our obligation as the next district attorney that I agree with everything that happens at the legislature. If that were the case, I think that our whole system would fail. Do we have disagreements? Absolutely. And a perfect example, whether we all agree philosophically or disagree with me, is Californians support the death penalty, but for 15 years the legislature has not done things to fix it, okay? I do not believe it's a DA's obligation to agree with everything the legislature says.
We have one final audience question before your three-minute summations. This goes to first to Mr. Leras. How would you feel about a citizen review board over officer shootings? And if you are in favor of such a review board, how would you go about selecting members?
You know, the problem with a citizen's review board could potentially be of some assistance in terms of identifying witnesses and identifying people who have relevant information. I wouldn't embrace the idea of a citizens review board making the determination about what the ultimate outcome is for one reason and one reason alone, and that is, that really is a function of determining the facts and then applying the law to the facts. However, we're not seeing that occurring. People believe that there is this predisposition ahead of time to have the outcome come a certain way, and that relevant information on the other side is being ignored. So a citizens review board, in terms of identifying that relevant information and providing it to the district attorney's office or the investigator so they can fully evaluate it, vet it, and incorporate it into the report, makes sense. What I think would also help is a true and independent review by the attorney general's office. I think that needs to happen in every case. Why? Because when you work in a county with those law enforcement officials, you become friendly with them. They become people that you know by first name, and you know their children, and you know the names of their pets. And now you're going to be called upon to make an evaluation as to whether or not what they did was justified or not. It seems to me that when you lay it all out, and you do that with the input of a citizens review board, so that you've considered relevant evidence, and the way you would do that is to go out to the local community leaders, and I've met a lot of them, and have representatives who come in. And when a representative's particular area is impacted, let's say, for example, the shooting is in Oak Park. There's an Oak Park representative. And that person's job becomes, they're instructed, you tell me what we've missed. If we've got names of people that we've missed, that we have relevant information, that should go into this report, and the report can't be complete until it's done. Then it's independently evaluated by the Attorney General's office, and the determination is made, well, is this a good shooting or not?
I think what's, first of all, I'm sure that there's a variety of different types of review boards that exist throughout the state. I want to understand, as the next district attorney, what role do the members of the review board play? I would agree with Mr. Leras that the most important thing that we get, if there is an officer-involved shooting or an in-custody death, is that we have full information and full facts from everybody, whether it's law enforcement, individual citizens, private citizens, people completely unrelated, so that we have a complete understanding of those facts. But the other part of that component is that the legal determination of whether or not this was a justifiable shoot or not is in fact that, a legal determination. And you must have an understanding of the laws that relate to self-defense, defense of others, and those types of things. And those are critical components. I don't have any problem, whether it's through a citizens review board of where we try to bridge the gaps of more information is brought. But I do not believe the citizens review board should make the legal determination on whether it was a correct shoot or not. So, thank you.
Rebuttal, Mr. Leras?
Yeah, I think that what we both agree on that idea, that it's got to be the district attorney who's evaluating the law, but more important in some ways than evaluating the law is also determining the facts. And that's where people really get upset, because they have a view that things are skewed. And if you read the Luis Gutierrez shooting report from Yolo County, as I have, you can see that every inference that could be drawn in favor of the officers was, no matter how far it had to be bent, and then Ms. Crowe did nothing to say, I want more information. That's not the kind of independent review I'm talking about. I'm talking about what District Attorney Jill Ravitch is doing with the Andy Lopez case in Sonoma County, saying, I want to meet with the officers, I want to meet with the family, and I want them to have input with the top deputy who's assigned to review the case. Then you'd have a citizen review board that could say, have you missed something? And then you make a determination. It seems to me that's the most rational way to deal with officer-involved shootings, so that they're fairly evaluated. Thank you.
That concludes the question and answer portion of the debate. Mr. Leras, you went second in the introductory remarks. You go first with closing remarks, 3 minutes.
Thank you. I really do appreciate not only being given the opportunity to speak here tonight, but also the high level of dialogue that Ms. Schubert and I have been able to have tonight about the differences in policy. And I hope you can see that these are policy differences, they're not personal differences, and that will always remain true. I think it's important to remember that the next district attorney should be somebody who can disagree without being disagreeable. That needs to be a person who is open-minded, who is willing to admit when failure has occurred. For too long, I think that there has been an atmosphere, and the defense bar has told me this repeatedly over and over again, of essentially the district attorney controls everything and determines what the offers are, what the resolutions are, what's fair, and there's this feeling that there's some heavy-handedness involved. That's why I think the next district attorney needs to be somebody who's got a broad range of experience. Someone, I don't know, who's been on both sides, perhaps been a federal prosecutor, might be good, I don't know. I'm not trying to make light of this. I'm saying these are important experiences I've had in my career. Let me tell you, one of the best parts about being a federal prosecutor was that every year at Christmas, the Federal Defender's Office holds a party. And if you don't go, and you're in the U.S. Attorney's Office, you are ridiculed. Let me say that again. If you say, I can't make it, your friends give you a hard time. Why? Because it's an opportunity for people to get together and break bread and show that they care about one another. I did that today at a birthday party for a federal district court judge, okay? I went in there, and there were people from probation, officers, defense attorneys from the private bar, federal defenders, magistrate judges, district court judges. Is this some fairyland that's imaginary? No. What's the difference between the federal system and the state system in terms of sentencing? Well, often in the federal system, the cases are much better, and the prosecutor has more power. So why do people get along so much better than state court? I'll tell you why. Because the tone is set from the very top. Be respectful, listen, And you don't go out and build your reputation by busting the chops of somebody because they happen to confess. One of the things that Ms. Schubert talked about was in evaluating cases saying, what'd you do and what's your record? But one of the things that I've seen this DA's office do that the U.S. Attorney's Office doesn't do is they factor in something else. What's my evidence? And it shouldn't be that. It shouldn't be that I got to walk in the park on this case, so I'm going to be a hard-nosed prosecutor. And I've got this really bad guy, and it's a tough case, and so I'm going to go lighter. Like the gentleman the other day who shot and killed his girlfriend down in South Sacramento who got 2 years for penetrating with a foreign object. That's the kind of guy, 2 years he was out after that, that's the kind of guy who needs to be put away, and his DA is my top priority.
Schubert.
Thank you. I think probably one of the most important things I want to emphasize today is, who am I? I'm Amory Schubert, okay? I'm not Jan Scully. I believe, I appreciate her support, but I got to my place in life as 24 years and my reputation because of the work that I have done. And my philosophy has never changed. It's always been the same, which is prosecution, prevention, and innovation. I think it's important because Mr. Leras and others think, oh, all we do is throw people in jail. I want to just talk for a second about what do we do currently. And I mentioned this earlier. The goal of all of us is to reduce recidivism and to make us safer so that we can all raise healthy families and live in a community that we feel good about. We have, in our county, a multitude of alternative sentencing courts. We have, as I mentioned, diversion, Prop 36. We have a mental health court, which is a tremendously successful program. We have a violation of probation court, so we divert people out of the system, where we won national awards. Those are the types of things that I'm talking about. In our misdemeanor world, I ran that court. I increased alternative sentencing options because I think it's important that we try to get to the root of things through education. As I mentioned earlier, one of the greatest programs that I'm probably the most proudest of is our truancy intervention program. It was aired on TV this week because it's different, because we got a national award for it, because we partner with people like the Public Defender's Office. Yes, we collaborate with individuals that we don't always necessarily see eye to eye with. So we go into schools and we educate kids because we know that truancy is the pipeline to prison and education is the key to success in our community. Do I intend to do that as an ex-district attorney, continue to do more of these prevention programs? Absolutely. Give you a couple examples. One, I want to go out to schools and educate parents and teachers about the dangers of social media, because I saw it in child abuse cases where, I'm sorry to say this, but perverts are using social media to lure children. We see them luring individuals to become victims of human trafficking. We see them using it for gang activities. Parents and teachers need to understand this so that we can better protect it. I want to get out in the community and do U-Visa projects. That's just another example. I want to get out in the community and do gang intervention programs similar to our truancy intervention program so that we can stop this on the front end and, as a result, raise healthier kids that are more successful and our community is safer. I am proud of the work that I've done. If anybody in this room knows me, I am not only passionate about what I do, I'm persistent, and when I tell you I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. So if somebody asks me, are you really going to go to the legislature and advocate for that? You can bet I'm going to do that. I'm not going to give up. And that's why I have the support of a broad base of the community, and that's why people from all different walks of life, different professions, whether we're on one side of the aisle or the other, whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, they support me because they know when I tell you I'm going to do it, I'm not only going to do it fairly and honestly, but I'm going to do it with reason and a maturity of judgment that every person in our system deserves and should demand. So thank you for that.
That concludes our debate this evening. First, I want to thank the National Lawyers Guild of Sacramento, the American Civil Liberties Union, and the Justice Reform Coalition. I also want to thank our audience for participating. The questions they presented were very meaningful. I want to thank our panelists for their questions. And I also especially want to thank our candidates for the wonderful job they did responding to questions and providing answers to questions rather than political stump speeches. They should be applauded for their